In this video, I will show you whether or not the 997 price has already bottomed out, and if so, which cars offer the best deals in today's market. What's up YouTube and welcome to a new video. Now the 911 997 is preferred by many over the 996 for obvious reasons. It namely loves those fried egg looking headlamps. Fortunately though, 997 prices came down a lot and they are now at a point where they start to become available for a larger group of people. And if you are one of those people, then you definitely need to keep on watching because I'm going to show you where the 997 fits on the 911 depreciation curve, how much you can expect to lose on your car per year and per 1,000 miles driven, how these rates compare to some other cars, and which cars offer the best value for money in today's market. Now we start off by taking a very broad market perspective and then we will slowly zoom in to the more detailed numbers. And we start with this graph right over here. You can see that we've model year on the horizontal axis and price on the vertical axis, and that each 911 for sale in the market is displayed by a bubble. You can also see that there's a blue solid line going through the graph, and that line represents the depreciation curve for the 911 market. If I put this on the big screen, you can also see that we have some black axes in the graph, and those represent the average price point for that given model year. And if we have a look to those average price points, then we can see that they fluctuate slightly here and there, and that there are some breaks between the different generations and facelifts. In general, however, the 911 market follows a quite neat depreciation curve. Now, the 997 generation was sold from 2004 till somewhere in 2012. So let's identify those cars with a different color. We can see now namely a very clear distinction in depreciation rates between the 911 991 and 911 997. The 997 is namely still depreciating at a rate of $3,834 per year, and the 991 at an average rate of $8,134 per year. Now, if you are more interested in the 911 991 market, then I strongly recommend that you check out my full depreciation analysis for that car. I have a separate video for the standard 991 and one for the S version. And the links for that will be appearing right over here. And I will also make sure to put them down below in the description. So be sure to check them out. We will, however, continue now by focusing on the 997 market and the different models in that market. This analysis is namely only including the Carrera 2, the Carrera 4, the Carrera 2S, and the Carrera 4S. And all of those models are appearing now right over here in a similar graph as the one which we've seen before. Now, however, we have only the 997 model years included and the different models are identified with the different colors. So let's have a look and see what is going on in the 997 market. Now you can see that in total, there are 461 cars for sale, and most of them are priced around $42,000. You can also see that the S models, which are here the blue and the green line, tend to be the most expensive ones. You can see namely clearly that these depreciation lines lay above the ones for the standard versions. If we look then to those depreciation lines, then we can see that the depreciation behavior is more or less the same for all models. Now the exception here is of course the standard Carrera 4. That line however just looks a little bit different due to the small number of data points in the most recent model years. Now if we look then to the depreciation numbers, then we can see that the base models depreciate at an average rate of $3,324 per year, and the S versions at an average rate of $3,750 per year. Now relatively, this number fluctuates somewhere between 8 and 10% of the average purchasing price for any of the models. Interestingly, it is the 4S which has the lowest relative depreciation rate, and we can see then also some large price fluctuations in the model year. These cars over here are, for example, priced significantly higher than the market. And it of course doesn't come as a surprise that these are the low mileage manual cars. They simply go for a premium compared to the rest of the market. Now the market for the 911 997 is quite large. And that of course means that you can look to that market from different perspectives. For example, you can have a look to the split between the 997.1 and 997.2. That split is now appearing on your screen, and you can clearly see that the 997.2 is significantly more expensive than the 997.1. The average premium for a 997.2 is namely $16,979. And as a result of this premium, you can see that there's a clear break in the market between the two generation types. Now, as I mentioned, there are many alternative views to this market. You can have a look to the split between transmission type, between the S and the standard versions, between the two-wheel drive and four-wheel drive versions, and between the coupes and the cabriolets. And if all of that is not enough, you can also split the market between the used cars and the used certified cars. Now, we will of course not go through all of them because that would take way too long. So let's have a look to the second most important aspect for the price of a 997, the mileage. The depreciation per 1000 miles driven is namely now appearing right over here, where you can see that we have the mileage on the horizontal axis and the price on the vertical axis. You can also see that there are again many depreciation lines, and that is because each model has its own depreciation curve. Now if you have a look to this graph, then we can see first of all that there's a huge variation going on in the mileage. You can find almost brand new cars with 0 miles driven, but you can also find ones which have more than 140,000 miles. Now if you have a look then to the depreciation behavior, then we can see that the patterns are, just as with the depreciation per year, very similar to each other. On average, however, a 997 loses around $315 per 1000 miles. Now this number deviates slightly between the model types, but not significantly. Now then, we covered quite some numbers and I already showed you quite some graphs. But it's a bit difficult to interpret all of these numbers without a context. After all, are the numbers high or are they low? That's exactly what we're going to find out now. And for that, we're going to use the depreciation leaderboard. That leaderboard namely shows the average depreciation rate for each car and compares them to each other. You can see then also that we have now the different cars on the horizontal axis and the relative average depreciation per year on the vertical axis. Now if we find then the 997 from that list, then we can see that it ranks actually somewhere in the middle of the graph with a rate of 6.4%. And this actually surprised me a little bit. It's namely quite high for a car with this age. I was expecting more something at around 5%. 6.4% on the other hand is more in line with the Ford Raptor, Z06 and M2. And those cars are of course all a lot newer. Now for most people looking to purchase a Porsche, this isn't an issue at all. After all, if you always dreamt about buying a 997, then these numbers are of course not so relevant at all. You should just go ahead and do it. But which car should you go for then? That is what we are going to find out now by using a relative value plot. Because that plot will help us to find the best value cars in today's market by looking for the car which has the lowest price, the newest model year and the lowest mileage. It is then also the combination of those three aspects which is likely to find you a good value for money car. The relative value plot is now appearing right over here, where you can see that we have the mileage on the horizontal axis and the price on the vertical axis. Each car is still represented by a bubble, but the bubbles have now a different size. It is namely so that the newer the model year of the car, the larger the size of the bubble. Then you can also see that they each have a different color, and that's because each color again belongs to a different model type. Now a car which immediately pops out as being a good value for money car is this car over here. This is a 2005 standard Carrera which has a little bit less than 40,000 miles. And you can see very clearly that this car over here is priced under the market compared to other cars with a similar mileage. In fact, it offered such a good value for money that it is already sold. So let's have a look to another example. For a little bit more, you can namely get this 2006 standard Carrera. This car namely has a mileage which is 10,800 miles below the average, but also a price which is below the average. The car is namely $3,123 cheaper than most other similar cars. And if you're interested in this car, you can find it at Infinity of Englewood. Now if we look a bit further then we can also see that this 997.2S offers excellent value for money. It namely has a price of $35,000 and a mileage of $46,000. Now the mileage is only 1000 miles below the average for this model and model year, but the price is around $5,000 lower. However, as is often the case with cars priced so low in the market, there is a little catch. This car namely doesn't have a clean title because the gearbox was replaced. And if that puts you off, no worries. The same price also gets you into this 2005 Carrera 4S. And I need to put a small disclaimer over here. All of the cars which I pointed out are not recommendations to buy. You still need to do your own research to find out if the car meets your criteria. Oh, and by the way, they're also not sponsored ads. The only person sponsoring this video is me. And with that out of the way, let's wrap up this video and conclude. Buying into the 997 market means that you are buying in at the tail of the 911's depreciation curve. Now, having said that, contrary to what you might expect, the depreciation curve didn't bottom out fully. There are, however, large differences when it comes to the depreciation between the model types, but also for each model type itself. We saw, for example, that low mileage 4S's with a manual go for a significant premium compared to the rest of the market. I, by the way, also found this effect for the standard 996, but to a much lesser extent than that I found it for the 4S. Now for you as a buyer, this means that you need to narrow down the model type you're interested in and only focus on that specific market. Luckily though, the 911 market is large enough and therefore allows for this kind of drilling down and analyzing. And with that, we arrived at the end of this depreciation analysis. Now, if you enjoyed this video or you found it helpful in any way, please remember to give it a thumbs up and to subscribe. You can of course also let me know down in the comments which car you would like to see analyzed next. Most of the time, I namely pick a car from there for my next video. As always, a huge thank you for watching, and I see you next week for a new analysis.